now move on to important aspect of manufacture of pharmaceuticals and how these are regulated by the DNC Act and rules. As we know, manufacture involves the unit processes in manufacturing of the formulations as well as their packaging, and these two are governed by the various provisions under the DNC Act and rules, which we will look into as we move forward. For the purpose of ease of implementation of the regulations for manufacture of drugs are divided into manufacture of drugs other than homeopathic drugs and manufacture of homeopathic drugs for the purpose of sale. Okay, any activity before it is carried out needs a license, and the licensing authority is what we have studied earlier. So an application should be made in the prescribed format to the licensing authority for the purpose of getting a license for manufacture of drugs for sale. If the drug is supposed to be manufactured in one location, then one license, one application is required. But if the drug is supposed to be manufactured on more than one set of premises, separate application is required for each location. The next step is upon getting the form for licensing, the licensing authorities will send their inspectors for inspecting the premises. The duty of the inspector is to inspect the premise, plant, equipment, instrument, process involved in the manufacture of the formulation, the means to be employed for quality control, or what is also called as standardization and testing. Additionally, and very important, is that they inquire into the professional qualifications of the technical staff. If the licensing authorities are satisfied that all the provisions as laid down in the DNC Act are fulfilled, then they will grant the license to manufacture this drug. Once the inspection is completed, the inspector will forward a detailed descriptive report to the licensing authority, which is a very important document to be preserved by the licensing authority, since it uses this data for issuing the license. The license so issued by the authority in the prescribed format is valid up to a period of 5 years from the date of grant, or if it is for renewal, then 5 years from the date of renewal. Thus, the licensing authority plays an important role in granting license for manufacture of drugs. Once it receives an application, it sends its team of inspectors who inspect the premises, inspects the equipment, instruments, the processes involved in manufacture, techniques used for quality control of the drugs, and if it is satisfied that all the rules and regulations are being complied with, the inspector sends a report to the licensing authority, which then grants license in the prescribed form. And this license that is granted is valid for a period of 5 years the first time, or subsequently when it is time to renew, again it can be renewed for 5 years. Okay. Thus, we have looked at the procedure for license for manufacture of drugs. Similar provisions exist for loan licensing, wherein the company gets its formulations manufactured by another party, smaller party, but for which purpose it has to apply for a loan license. Sometimes the manufacturers import drugs into the country in larger bulk quantities, which are then packed into smaller containers. Such a repacking is also permissible, provided appropriate repacking license has been obtained from the licensing authority. An important point to note here is that li such licenses for manufacture of drugs are issued to persons or organizations who have their own arrangement for the manufacture and testing of drugs. Okay? So remember, just anyone cannot apply for a license to manufacture without having the appropriate infrastructure, which includes the premises, the instruments, equipments, the processes, the control, as well as the technically qualified persons. Thus, license for manufacture of drugs is issued by the licensing authority to persons or organizations who have their own arrangements for manufacture and standardization of drugs. As you know, drugs fall into different categories and different schedules. There is no one common license for manufacture of any of these drugs. Different licenses are required for the manufacture of different classes of drugs. To tell you in brief about loan license, a loan license is issued to a person who does not have his own arrangements for manufacture, but who intends to avail himself of the manufacturing facilities that are owned by another licensee. Such a thing is permissible. However, the licensing authority will satisfy itself that such a manufacturing unit has adequate equipment, staff, capacity for manufacture, and facilities for testing to undertake manufacture on behalf of the applicant for a loan license. The loan licensing is very common in the pharmaceutical industry, and it is a win-win situation for both the one who gives the product on loan license and the loan licensee. However, it is important that the loan licensee who is going to manufacture the drug has his own infrastructure, including equipment, staff, capacity to manufacture, as well as testing facilities, right? So the manufacturer of a drug who does not have his own facility yet wants to manufacture with the help of another party who is interested has to apply for loan license for manufacture of drugs to the licensing authority. The licensing authority will carry out an inspection of the premises of the loan licensee and satisfy himself that the manufacturing unit has equipments, staff, capacity to manufacture, and facilities to test before he gives the license. Sometimes a pharma manufacturer will neither manufacture in his premise nor will he manufacture as a part of loan license. What the manufacturer does is he or she imports the drugs from another country into India and in bulk, that is large packings, and then breaks up this subdivides this formulation into smaller parts. This is called as repacking of drugs. Even repacking of drugs requires a license. Thus, a license is granted for the purpose of breaking up any drug from a bulk container into smaller packages and labeling of each package with a view to its sale and distribution. So whenever a manufacturer, instead of manufacturing, imports the drug in bulk, when I say drug, I mean formulation in bulk from another country, he cannot sell the bulk as such because there will be no buyers. The patient is going to buy only as much as he or she wants. Therefore, the manufacturer or the importer has to pack the drug in smaller quantities in smaller containers, which he can do so only if he applies for and is granted the license for repacking of drugs. Now, remember, repacking is not the same as compounding or dispensing of drugs that is done in a dispensary. This refers to the repacking of drugs that have been imported with a view to sale and distribution. Such repacking licenses can be issued only for certain categories of drugs, those drugs that are specified in Schedule C, C1 and X cannot be repacked. They can be imported and sold, but they cannot be repacked. The procedure for manufacture of drugs for sale starts with the application for the license, followed by grant of license. Okay. So the first time the license is granted, it is granted in a particular form number, whereas after 5 years when the license is to be renewed, a renewal certificate comes in a different form. So manufacturer of a drug other than those specified in C, C1 and X will apply in form 24. The first time if he is applying, he will be granted the license in form 25. At the end of 5 years, when he applies for a renewal, he will apply in the same application form 24, but he will receive the license in form 26. Grant of license or renewal of license to manufacture drugs that are specified in Schedule X and XB, the application form is 24F. The license is granted in form 25F. And if there is a renewal, then the renewal certificate is granted in form 26F. The license for manufacture of drugs specified in Schedule C and C1, the application form is made in form 27. License is granted the first time in form 28, and on subsequent renewals, the form that is issued, the license is issued in the form 26. So on and so forth. So you can go through this table and you can understand for yourself that manufacturing of any formulation from a drug requires a license. The application, the format of the application for license is given in Drugs and Cosmetics Act. The same has to be filled and submitted, and the license is obtained in a fresh application, in a fresh form, the numbers for which I have put up here. At the end of 5 years or before the end of 5 years, the application, the license expires. Therefore, fresh application for renewal of license has to be made, and it is issued in the following license number, in the following form numbers. Earlier that manufacturing can be subdivided into two parts: manufacturing of drugs other than homeopathic medicines and manufacture of homeopathic medicines. So if a manufacturer wishes to manufacture for purpose of sale certain homeopathic medicines, then he too has to apply for a license, and the form in which application is made is 24C. The first time the license is obtained in the form 25C, and subsequent renewals will see application in the form 20, the renewal of the license in form 26C. Similarly, formats for license application for license for manufacture of cosmetics are fixed. The numbers are shown in the right hand side in the very first column here. The form in which license is obtained as shown in the middle column, and the form in which renewal license is obtained is there in the last column. You can go through it out of your own interest. Similarly, if a manufacturer wishes to manufacture by the route of loan license, then he has to apply for a license. License is obtained the first time and renewed subsequently. The form numbers vary if the drugs belong to Schedule C, C1 and X, or if the drugs are other than C1 and X. Similarly, repacking license only for those drugs which are not specified in Schedule C1 and X. Application is made in form 24B. The first time license is obtained in 25B, and in subsequent renewals, 26B is the form in which license to repack will be obtained. Once the license to manufacture drugs, whichever schedule they belong to, whether they are homeopathic or other than homeopathic, the next step is that the pharmaceutical manufacturer should comply with the conditions that are laid down in the DNC Act for manufacture of drugs. In this slide, we are going to look at the general conditions for manufacture of drugs other than those specified in Schedule C, C1 and X. The first point written here, let me just read it out. The manufacture shall be conducted under active direction and supervision of competent technical staff consisting at least one full-time employee. So remember, this is the importance of being a pharmacist. The pharmacist is mandatory for the manufacture of formulations, and the DNC Act and rules say that competent technical staff of which at least one full-time employee should be actively supervising the manufacture and packing of the formulation. Second important point is that the premises should comply with Schedule M. What is Schedule M? Schedule M is the requirements of GMP that are given laid down in this schedule. So good manufacturing practices should be followed. For more details, read up Schedule M in DNC Act and Rules. There should be adequate space, good facilities, good location, and proper equipment for manufacturing operations, and this should be in line with the requirements of Schedule M. Not only manufacture is important, but equally important is the testing of the quality of the formulations that have been manufactured. Therefore, it is important to have that the location should have adequate testing facilities. As you know, one of the requirements of GMP is that records should be generated. Records with respect to manufacture, testing, packing, cleaning, etc. It is very important that all these records are maintained for a period of at least 2 years beyond the date of expiry. So if a batch has been manufactured today, then its manufacturing date is June 2021. If its expiry is 2 years down the line, then its expiry date is May 2023. And the DNC rules say that all records pertaining to this batch should be preserved till May 2025 at least. Adequate samples of each manufactured batch should be kept so that if needed, sample can be provided to the authorities. Remember the duties, functions and responsibilities of drug inspectors and government analysts. The drug inspector will collect the samples and the analyst will analyze them. Now, if there is no sample, how will the drug inspector collect, isn't it? That is why it is necessary to keep aside adequate samples for handing over to the requisite authorities. Also, stability study should be carried out and data should be generated and preserved so that this data can be furnished to the drug inspectors or to the regulatory authorities if required. In addition, there should be some record of the inspection of the premises by the drug inspectors. This is done via an inspection book. So it is mandatory to maintain an inspection book in a particular format, the format for which is given in Form 35, to enable the drug inspector to record his impressions and complaints and defects, if any. Okay. Lastly, it is also important to maintain reference samples from each batch in a quantity that is sufficient to completely analyze this batch twice. So, if 50 tablets are required for complete analysis of the batch, then 100 tablets will be kept aside as reference samples. This is different. This is apart from the sample that is kept for giving to the authorities. Okay. So, you have two types of samples. One which is kept for handing over to authorities, and the second which is called as reference samples, which are maintained for a long period of time and which may be necessary in case of there is any complaint received from the market or in case the company decides to increase the shelf life of the product and several other reasons. Thus, in this slide, we have looked at the general conditions for manufacture of drugs that were not there in schedule C, C1 or X. Okay, so in depth conditions and regulations are provided in the DNC Act, which you can see as you go along. The licensee shall have adequate testing facilities for testing of each batch of raw material and finished product. Now, like I told you, it is important to not only manufacture, it is also important to test the quality of the product. However, the quality of the product can be built into the product only if the raw materials are appropriate. So, testing of the raw materials and testing of the finished product is important. This can be carried out by the manufacturer either in his own laboratory or he can also carry it out in a government approved laboratory. All records of manufacture and testing are to be maintained as per Schedule U for a period of 5 years. From time to time, the staff may change. There may be changes in the technical people who are employed with the company. It is important to report to the licensing authority if there are any exchanges in the expert staff who are supervising the manufacturing or the testing of drugs. This I already mentioned to you earlier. Let me just read through. It is necessary that the company maintains an inspection book in Form 35, where the drug inspector who has inspected the premise records his impressions and any deficiencies if noticed by him. Also, the company shall maintain account of all transactions. What are the important details that are required to be noted down with respect to each and every batch that is manufactured? Let us first look at the drugs, manufacture of drugs which are specified in Schedule X. In case of drugs belonging to Schedule X that are used for the manufacture of formulations, then the following details should be noted down very carefully. Date of issue of this drug or API, name of the API, opening balance of stock. So before weighing and dispensing for the day, what is the opening balance? What is the quantity weighed and received and the source from where it is received, where this drug has been manufactured and received from, the quantity that goes into the batch, actual batch, the closing balance or the balance quantity at the end of the day, production day, and signature of the person in charge. So basically this means that where a drug is potent, it has to be reconciled. What is the amount of drug present at the start of the day? What is the amount of drug weighed and issued to the tablet department? What is the amount of drug, what is the number of tablets that have come out? What is the balance amount of the drug in the raw material stores? All this is very, very important. In addition, details in the production department which need to be noted include date of manufacture, name of the drug, batch number, quantity of raw material that is used in the manufacture, the theoretical yield or anticipated yield, the actual yield, wastage if any, and the quantity of goods that were finally manufactured and transferred to the storage or the warehouse. Thus, you can see that it is very important to maintain adequate documentation with respect to drugs belonging to Schedule X. Other important aspects that need to be documented include date of manufacture of the batch, name of the drug, the batch number, the opening balance in the production department, the quantity used for actual manufacture, and finally the quantity of the formulation sold. Thus, it is necessary to have all such details pertaining to tracing back the drug, tracing back the formulation, and in this respect it is also important to have the name of the purchaser of the end product and the address which is to be done at the chemist level. Also important is balance quantity of the drug or the formulation at the end of the day and signature by the responsible person. It is important to note that the DNC Act says that the drugs specified in Schedule X in bulk form should be stored in bulk form, and when such a drug is required for manufacture in a place other than its place of storage, it shall be kept in a separate place under the direct custody of a responsible person. So great care has to be taken in dealing with drugs belonging to Schedule X. Additionally, the licensee will comply with all other requirements that are specified under the Schedule M. The general conditions that we discussed so far were for the manufacture of drugs other than Schedule C and C1. However, those were the formulations that were official in the pharmacopoeia. What about those formulations which are not official or which are patent or proprietary? What are the conditions for the manufacture of such drugs? Let us see. The applicant shall, while applying for a license to manufacture patent or proprietary medicines, furnish to the licensing authority evidence and data justifying that this medicine contains the ingredients in therapeutic or prophylactic quantities as determined in relation to the claims or conditions for which the medicines are recommended for use or are claimed to be useful. The medicines are safe for use as far as the vehicle, the excipient, the additive, and the pharmaceutical aid is concerned, and they are safe under the conditions in which the formulation is administered and used. These medicines are stable under standard storage conditions, and these medicines contain ingredients and in such doses for which there is a therapeutic justification. Now remember, a patent or proprietary medicine is one which is not official, and the manufacturer is free to add the API and excipients of his choice. However, he cannot randomly decide on the API, the dose, or the excipients to be used. He has to prove that the ingredients are in therapeutic and prophylactic quantities. All ingredients, that is API and excipients, are safe, stable, the formulation is stable, and there is a therapeutic justification for this formulation. It is a rationalized dosage form that can cure, treat, mitigate, or prevent any particular disease. What about those drugs which are mentioned in Schedule C-C1? Now, the drugs that are mentioned in Schedule C-C1 are of biological origin. So, sterility and absence of microorganisms and pyrogens plays a very important aspect of these formulations which are biological in origin. Therefore, the DNC Act has laid down certain conditions for which are to be complied with while manufacturing drugs belonging to Schedule C-C1. And here some of the conditions I have laid down, which I am reading out to you. The drugs must be issued, when I mean issued, they should be weighed in previously sterilized, sealed glass or suitable container. All the containers should comply with Schedule F. Some classes of organisms that microorganisms for which testing is done is aerobic and anaerobic microorganisms. So if your formulation is a serum based formulation or insulin or hormones, then such formulation has to be necessarily tested, and it should be proved that aerobic and anaerobic microorganisms are absent. Serum products should be tested for abnormal toxicity. Parenteral preparations in doses of 10 ml or more should be tested for freedom from pyrogens. Separate laboratory for culture and manipulation of spore-bearing pathogens should be present. So it is very important to have separate facilities for the testing of these biological products. And very important is test for sterility. So test for absence of microorganisms, absence of pyrogens, and sterility is very, very important. Therefore, handling in aseptic conditions and using sterile containers is necessary as far as manufacture of drugs belonging to Schedule C and C1 are concerned. Drugs belonging to Schedule X are narcotics and psychotropic drugs, and therefore it is very important to ensure that there is appropriate control over their procurement, manufacture as well as sale. For this purpose, the DNC Act says that account of all transactions related to the manufacture and packing of the drugs should be not only be maintained but preserved for 5 years. It is necessary to send the invoice of sale of such drugs and formulations to the licensing authority once every 3 months. These drugs, because of their nature, should be stored in such a manner that they are in the direct custody of a responsible and a technically qualified person. This drug as well as its formulations must be labeled with this sign, the XRX sign, which indicates that this is a Schedule X drug for dispensing only against the prescription. Such formulations should be marketed in packing which is not exceeding 100 tablets or capsules at a time, 300 ml in the form of oral liquid or 5 ml in the form of injectables. We have seen earlier that a loan license is one wherein a manufacturer will not manufacture it in his own premises but will manufacture the drug in a different premise under a loan license. So the definition of loan license is that a person who does not have his own arrangements for manufacture but wishes to manufacture in a facility owned by another licensee. Then the license which is applied for by this first person is called as loan license. The drugs for which loan license is issued is drugs other than that specified in Schedule C, C1 and X or loan license for drugs specified in Schedule C, C1. That is all other drugs other than biologicals and narcotic and psychotropic drugs can be manufactured under one license, and drugs that are of biological origin, so C1, can be manufactured under another type of loan license. Drugs belonging to Schedule X cannot be manufactured under loan license. So for the purpose of application of a license, an original loan license application in form 25A or a renewed loan license, I'm sorry, this is not application, this is license, in form 26A can be procured. Unless it is cancelled or suspended, will be valid for a period of 5 years from the date on which it is granted or renewed. So a loan license is applied for and obtained in form 25A the first time, or subsequent renewals in form 26A, and is valid for 5 years and needs to be renewed every 5 years. The loan licensee who applies for the loan license shall comply with the provisions of the Act. Also, the licensee shall test each batch of raw material and finished product and shall maintain records or registers to show the tests that are carried out in compliance with Schedule U, and such records and registers shall be retained for a period of 5 years. And 2 years, totally 5 years, and 2 years after date of expiry for those products which have an expiry date on the label. The loan licensee shall allow inspectors to inspect all registers and records that are maintained as per the rules and shall supply necessary information that is required by the authority. The loan licensee shall maintain adequate staff and laboratory for carrying out the tests on the finished products, tests that can prove the strength, quality and purity of the manufactured product. he or she shall maintain reference sample from each batch for a period of 3 months after expiry. The loan licensee shall furnish data on the stability of drugs, and the loan licensee shall maintain form 35, that is the book in which the inspector notes down his observations and deficiencies. Next, we come to the repacking license. Repacking is nothing but the process of breaking up any drug. When I say drug here, I mean product or formulation, from a bulk container into small packages and labeling them with a view to their sale and distribution. We have seen earlier that only those drugs which do not belong to Schedule C, C1 or X can be repacked. That means drugs of biological origin cannot be repacked, and narcotic drugs, psychotropic drugs cannot be repacked. All other drugs can be imported and packed in smaller containers for the purpose of sale and distribution. Let us now look at the conditions under which repacking can be done. The repacking of drugs shall at all times be conducted under the personal supervision of at least one person who is approved as a competent person by the licensing authority. So, repacking cannot be done by anybody and everybody. It requires the presence of a qualified pharmacist. The licensee shall either provide and maintain adequate arrangement in his own premises for carrying out the tests related to proving the strength, quality and purity of the drugs repacked, or make arrangements with some institution or laboratory that has been approved by the licensing authority for carrying out such tests. And such tests have to be regularly carried out by the approved laboratory on behalf of the loan licensee. The repacking licensee. The licensee shall make adequate arrangements for the storage of the drugs, whether it is the bulk form or whether it is in the divided form. The licensee shall comply with the provisions of the Act and of the rules, with further requirements, if any, as may be specified in the rules. I told you that the Drugs and Cosmetics Act and rules are being amended from time to time. So, if any new requirements come up in the amendments with respect to repacking, then the licensee has to comply with those requirements. The licensee shall allow any inspector appointed under the Act to enter with or without notice any premise where the packing of the drugs is being carried out, and allow him to inspect the premises as well as take samples of the repacked drugs. Thus, it is the responsibility of the licensee who has got the license for repacking of drugs to allow the inspectors to inspect their premises and take samples if necessary. The licensee shall, either in his own laboratory or in any other laboratory approved by the licensing authority, test each batch or lot of raw material that has been used by him for repacking, and also each batch of the product thus repacked, and shall maintain the records or registers showing the particulars in respect of such tests that have been carried out. Also, the records or registers shall be retained for a period of 5 years from the date of repacking. So, whatever is the drug product being repacked, it has to be tested before being repacked in its original container. After being repacked, the smaller containers or packages also have to be tested, and the packaging material used also has to be tested. all records of these testings that have been carried out have to be maintained for a period of 5 years from the date of repacking. The licensee shall allow the inspector to inspect all the registers and records maintained under these rules and shall supply to the inspector such information as he may require for the purpose of confirming whether the provisions of the Act and rules have been observed. Before we move forward, the following PPT shows two of the important books that give a very good compilation of the various requirements under the DNC Act. The first one is a textbook of forensic pharmacy by N.K. Jain, and you also have another book by B.M. Mittal which you can refer. Also, you can download the DNC Act and rules which is available on the net.